وهو الغفور الودود. दिल ठिकाना Angels that are crowded around this gathering, all the way up to Ash, because you're remembering Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So congratulations, pat yourself on the back for getting the opportunity to be blessed and have received the invitation to coming to a blessed gathering like this. So without further ado, I know that you've been waiting. Inshallah, I'd like to request our honorable guest speaker, Professor Inam, uncle, if you could please bless us. Oh, Zuhur, inshallah, if he was on the request of the honorable guest speaker, and also all of us as well, if you could bless us with an Nas Sharif, we would be honored as well, before the program starts.
As-salamu alaykum. I think you are all well aware of today's events going on vis-a-vis MCC and MEC. This is a priority program, and the dinner is going on over there, which inshallah I want to go there too. So that will be after this. The news about this program was broken to me by Professor Saw. And then I pledged to myself, inshallah, I will try to make it. So the kids have gone there and have come here, inshallah, meet them. Ek naat, bulke naat ya gazal. By Nasir Kazmi.
Mm-hmm. رحمت والے
So I'm going to talk a little bit about remembrance, zikr. And then we will talk a little bit about remembrance of our Prophet Muhammed. Haq Saheb and Sameer has heard a little bit of that zikr in Urdu. So today they can hear it in English also. One of the important themes in the Quran repeatedly presented is zikr. And in fact, from Quranic point of view, one of the greatest sickness of the heart is forgetting the zikr. The opposite of zikr is ghafla. And Quran repeatedly says that people are in a state of ghafla. وَلْهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ. And this ghafla, heedlessness, not being attentive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His prophets and His awliya, that creates misguidance. Eras, moving away from the right path. And out of these zikrs, of course, the greatest zikr is zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya ayyuhal ladheena aamanu uzkuru Allaha zikran katheeran. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly. Fasabbihuhu bukratan wa asila. And glorify Him in the morning and the evening. So remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest zikr. But then Quran also talks that there are people, the people of God, that they also need to be remembered. And we should not forget them. So many places Quran will say, وَذْكُرْ عَبْدَنَا عَبْدَنَا. Remember our servant Ayyub. Remember him, don't forget him. He was our servant. نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ وَاللَّهُ. What a beautiful servant he was. That he will always come back to you again and again and again. وَذْكُرْ عِبَادَنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ. And remember our servants, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Ishaq alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salam. وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمَ. Remember this book in the scripture. Our female servant, Maryam. And there are many such remembrances in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands that it is not only He as the creator and absolute master of the universe who needs to be remembered, but there are also people who need to be remembered. That we should not. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in mysterious ways keeps their remembrance alive. That this remembrance with the passage of time will not disappear. Sometimes we may not see it as much as we may see in another time. But this remembrance is always there. I went to Uzbekistan a few years back. When Uzbekistan has gotten freedom from Soviet Union. Not many years have passed. And I went to the tomb of Imam Bukhari. Now, during the Soviet rule, which was communist and atheist, it was not allowed even to pray in a mosque, but even to hold a copy of Quran, because religion was completely banned and even suppressed. So there was no idea of going to the tomb of Imam Bukhari. But I was that people were coming to the tomb and the mosque which is next to it. And they will pray. And they will recite the Holy Quran. And I did not see anybody doing any shirk or any kufr, any bid'ah there. Now this is Imam Bukhari radiallahu anhu. That when he was alive, he devoted his life to collect the hadith of Prophet and sometimes he will travel for months just to collect one hadith. If someone told him that there is a person in Kufa or in Mosul who has a hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will travel. And when he will travel, he will walk barefoot because he did not have shoes. He was that poor. And he will stop in various mosques to eat the food, because he could not afford to buy the food. And after all these years and all this work, he returned to Bukhara, where he was from. And when he came to Bukhara, in the court of Amir of Bukhara, there were muftis and alims who conspired against him to expel him from the city. There is no shortage of these muftis and these ulama children. And they were there at that time too. And they filled his ears, Amir of Bukhara, that his aqidah is not right. And they built a conspiracy against him that he was forced to leave Bukhara. And he moved to Samarkand, about 2-3 hours drive, where he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he should call him back to himself. And his prayer was accepted. And within a few months, he died. When he was being buried, and his grave was done, the perfume which came out of his grave filled the whole city. And people started to come to collect the dust. So they will come and collect the dust from his grave and take it home for the Baraka. So the Wali of Samarkand created a fence and covering to block the tomb lest they take all the dust. I go to Palestine quite often. We have some programs there. And whenever I go to the tomb of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, of Khalil Ibrahim. In the whole Palestine, Ibrahim or Al Khalil is the most depressing place. There is unbelievable oppression in that part of the city because extremist Jews want to take over the city and completely eliminate Muslim population. In order to enter the tomb of Imam Ibrahim alayhi salam, you have to go, one has to go through military checkpoints. One has to go through body searches. But despite all this harshness of the conditions and oppression of the environment, you are surprised that people keep coming. They go through all the hardship. And if we think with our own rational mind, secular mind, moral and scientific mind, we will ask why somebody will pay all this pain, this trouble, this investment of money and time to come to a grave, to the tomb of the Prophet. And I have seen this in many, many places in the world. In Turkey, when the secular tyranny of Ataturk disappeared, and military rule weakened, and things opened up. I see how people flock to the tomb of Jalaluddin. It's hard to get in. When I went first time about 12 years ago, a Turkish friend of mine, he said that if you can get up early on Friday morning, I want to take you to a place. And I said, sure, why not? So he picked me early in the morning and he took me to the tomb of Abu Ayyub Ansari. He was the host of Prophet when he migrated to Medina. And on that tomb, and there is a mosque next to it, there were at least 4,000 to 5,000 people before Fajr. And they were reciting, there is a very famous book of Awrad, Al-Jawshan al-Kabir, which is very popular in Turkey. It goes to Salim Mursi and some of the other. And they were all reciting it. And they were virtually all young, not old people, boys and girls. We just had the month of Muharram. We are now entering the summer. And the zikr of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, as it survived throughout time, is remarkable and unbelievable. When Yazid consolidated his power, they banned the remembrance of Imam Hussain. And they extremely suppressed the family of Prophet. In fact, every Imam of Al-Bayt, he died because of poisoning or murder. None of them died a natural death. because they were extremely fearful of their power and their influence on the community. Imam Nasai, who is one of the sixth collectors of our hadith, he created a book. He compiled a book of hadith in exalted status of Imam Ali, Manaqib Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he presented that book to his students in Mosque of Umayya, the Masjid. And when he presented this hadith, the gangsters of Umabi kingdom, they came and they beat him. And they asked him that he should produce a similar book in Manaqib of Nabil Muhammad. And he said, there is no hadith. There is not in his place. So where should I get those hadiths? Should I fabricate them? False hadiths I should produce. Now we respect all Sahaba, because Sahaba have highest degree because of their relationship with Prophet. But all Sahaba are not equal. Quran says some are superior than others. There are Sahaba, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, given the view of paradise of this earth, but did not say the same thing about others. There are 124,000 Sahaba, but we don't find in hadith more than 25, but at the most 30. So the status of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, Sayyidina Muhammad, Sayyidina Usman, Sayyidina Ali, is much higher. But they beat him to the point where he eventually died of these wounds. Imam Nasai. Imam Hassan al-Basri, who was the great Qadi, and narrated many hadiths in our Sahih Bukhari in Muslim. He narrated quite a few hadiths in which he does not mention the Prophet. He does not mention the Sahaba, the companion who heard of the Prophet. And he is directly quoting the hadith from the Prophet. Technically, that makes a hadith weak, because hadith should authentically connect to Prophet. If the link is missing, then you don't know who is the Sahabi who heard it, and who is the Tabi who heard it from Sahabi, then it creates a flaw in the hadith. Because this hadith is supposed to. And when one of his students asked Imam Hassan al-Basri that you are quoting this hadith from whom? And he started to cry. And he says, all these ahadith are from Sayyidina Ali. And I do not mention his name because these Umayyad rulers which suppress the hadith and hide it, that they don't want anything going out which glorifies and exalts the person of Sayyidina Ali. The Umayyad rule, which ended in mainland Muslim territories within 90 years, did not survive for long. But one of their branch, which succeeded to take over Andalus, ruled for almost 200 years. A And under their rule, it was prohibited to glorify the martyr of Imam Hussein. In fact, sometimes they were cursed from members. And political blame will be imposed on Imam Hussein. As today you find many people who do that. Oh, he said, oh, he made a big mistake. No, he shouldn't have done this, he shouldn't have done that. And they will officially teach that Khulafa'i Rashidin, or Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, and Muawiyah. And they will remove the name of Imam Hassan and Imam Ali from Khulafa'i Rashidin. Now, while they were doing that, it was the ordinary Muslim and the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah who were keeping the memory of Hussein alive. They would hold the sessions to remember Imam Hussein. And they would hold the Ashura. There is a book titled Ashura in Sunni Islam. Person with PhD in that. That these common people, they had this deep love for Prophet. In fact, one of the poetry which produced the Quran is Al-Maraf al-Husayniya. Lamented poetry of sorrow and grief, like we have in Urdu, Marsiya of Anis al-Tabim. Marath, as there was not for Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there was mercy to the Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And the love of common people was such that, I just give you one example, that Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn, Zain al-Abidin, who was the only male survivor of the tragedy of Karbala. And he survived because he was so sick that he couldn't come out of his tent. And after the tragedy of Karbala, Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin, and the title Zain al-Abidin, the adornment of worshippers, the beauty of worshippers, was given to him, the greatest Sunni Imam of that time. His name was Shahabuddin Zuhri, Imam Zuhri. So Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin, he settled in Medina. And he created his convent, the Ribab, where people will study and worship. And he never indulged in politics. And he was so devoted to worship that his title was As-Sajjad, that he was always in Sajjad. And he never forgot the tragedy of Karbala. Whenever food was served to him, he would cry. And he would have a hard time to eat it. And people will say, oh, Imam, many years have passed. He survived 34 years after Karbala. So they will say, many years have passed, and you have not forgotten. And he will say, and look, Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam lost his one son. And he eventually got it back. He didn't die. He brought it back. And Quran says, وَبِيَضَّتَ عَيْنَاهُ مِنْ حُزْنِ. Out of sorrow his eyes became light. So I have lost my whole family and the family of Prophet. How I can forget? One time, Hisham bin Abdul Malik, who was the prince, who became king later on, he came to Medina for Hajj. And he wanted to kiss Hajar Aswad. But nobody gave him chance, because there was such a big crowd that he could not reach and touch Hajar Aswad. And then Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin came, and when people saw him, they stopped and they made a row for him. So he should walk, and he go, and he kissed Hajar Aswad. And Hisham got so upset that he said, who is this man with contempt? I am the king. Who is this man? People are respecting him so much. Now these kings used to have official poets with them, and these poets used to write poetry in praise of kings. In fact, some Saudis are even today princes. They have their own poets, and these poets write poetry. And Hisham's poet is one of the greatest poets in Arabic language. His name is Farazda. But when he said, who is this person? His official poet, Farazda, became so angry that he immediately wrote poetry in praise of Imam Ali Zahra. And he says, you do not know this person. Kaaba knows him. Kaaba knows him. هَذَا الَّذِي تَعْرِفُ الْبَطْحَى وَتَعْرِفُ that he is the person that the dust of Makkah recognizes his footstep. And this Kaaba knows him. And everyone who lives here and everyone who comes to this house knows him. وَإِنْ رُدَّ أَهْلُ التُّقَى كَانُوا أَئِمَّةً وَإِنْ قِيلَ مَنْ خَيْرُ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. If you count the people of Taqwa, he is their imam. And if someone asks, where is the best of humanity, they should look at him. He is the best of humanity. وَلَيْسَ قَوْلُكَ مَنْ هَذَا بِظَاهِرِهِ الْعَرَبُ تَعْرِفُ مَنْ كَرْبُ الْعَجَمُ. You're saying, who is he is not going to hurt him? Because Arab knows him. So of course Hisham fired him. And then he fired him. Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin sent him 10,000 dinars, which he sent back. And he said, if I needed money, I would have stayed in Hisham.
SubhanAllah.
But there is no honor higher than defending the honor of prophets.
Allah. SubhanAllah.
This is the history which we have not taught. We have mosques in this city. If you attend them 50 years, you will not hear one sermon about it. Not one sermon even about the status of prophets. You will hear a sermon about George Bush and Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton. You will not hear a sermon about who this prophet is. Imam Shabi radiallahu anhu, 7th century, was one of the greatest Sunni Imam and Alim. And he would say to his students, his murids, his disciples, that there are mosques in this city. You are better off sitting on the heap of garbage than attending. Say that the way this mosque will destroy your soul, the heap of garbage will not. And this is his time, which was the best time. We are living in a very dark time. We are not living in the Khayr al-Qurun of the best time. And this is the unfortunate reality. It is truly one of the darkest periods in Islamic history. It has never been that dark. Now, here, a question arises. That what is that which keeps this remembrance alive? Why this remembrance does not die, despite many governments' effort, many misguided sects thereafter? That this is a good thing, this remembrance should disappear, but it doesn't die. No matter what they do, this zikr and this remembrance remains alive. The answer to that is in many hadiths. But in this particular hadith of Prophet Muhammad, which is muttafaq alayh in Bukhari, Muslim, and many other collections, where Prophet says, إن الله تعالى إذا أحب عبدا على دينه. That it happens that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He falls in love with one of His servants. There is something there that He becomes, that this person becomes His beloved. He loves him. And when he loves him, he calls Jibreel alayhi salam and he says, oh Jibreel, you know this person, son of this person, in that city, in that town, that person I love. And then he says, Jibreel, you must love him too. Amen. So Jibreel alayhi salam loved him, and then he says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that now go and announce this in the whole world of heavens, that this person is Allah's beloved. So all the angels and all the spirits, they know that this person is the beloved of Allah. And then Prophet says, ثُمَّ يُوْضَى لَهُ الْرُّوْلِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. That when this love is established in heavens, then it is brought down on the side. So when it enters this heart, it's already established in heavens. So now this love does not disappear. So people don't forget. They don't forget. They don't forget. When the love is established in heavens, we don't forget. Because when we remember someone, our remembrance is a good deed. Our remembrance is our good deed, so good act. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers someone, then that is jaza of the amal. It's not amal. His remembrance is jaza, the reward. Our remembrance is an act. His remembrance is jaza, reward of that act. So if our remembrance is limited, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala carries infinitude, because He is infinite. So when He remembers, then remembrance does not go away. Inna awliya'i wa ahibba'i alladhina yazkuruna bizikri wa uzkuru bizikri. Hadith al-Qudsi. I have my awliya, my friends, and I have my beloveds. If you remember them, you remember me. And if you remember me, you remember them. Because these remembrances are connected. They can't be separated. Now, if this is the remembrance of exalted people, then you can imagine that what will be the status of remembrance of Prophet. Who is the highest in the created order? That there is nothing more than him. Because he is being remembered and elevated by Allah and his angels all the time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not do any other act of worship which we do. He does not pray 5 times, neither he fasts. But he remembers often. So when we send salat and salam to Prophet, we actually join this universe. We join this holy world of Allah and His angels and His noble arwah, who are constantly remembering Prophet. So this remembrance does not die for a moment. There should be no question, why should we remember? Why we should not? Who is remembered by Allah and His angels all the time? Now, there are objections, criticisms, which are launched on remembrance of Prophet or celebrating Mawlid, which are in fact totally baseless and have virtually no religious argument. soil. First of all, remembrance can take different forms. And these forms cannot be limited in time and scope. During the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see many occasions that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being praised by the Sahaba. There are 14 Sahaba who wrote naat, that their naat exists today. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a minbar in Masjid Nabawi especially for Hassan bin Sabit radiallahu anhu. And he said, Hassan, you sit on this minbar and you praise me.
Subhanallah.
Here's a hadith. Hadith of Aisha. Now today, if you pray not in the mosque, they will say it's bid'ah. Here's a hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a special minbar in the mosque of Medina for Imam, for Hazrat Hassan bin Sabit, that he should sit on that member and recite the naat. We see in the hadith a Sahabi comes from some part of Africa and he puts Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he makes him sit in a chair and then he goes and dances around him and sings. Prophet asked him, and he says, O Prophet, in our city, the place I come from, this is the way we praised our kings. And you are the king of the whole
world.
He didn't say this is bid'ah. When Prophet migrates to Medina, the whole city comes and sings and children dance. We teach our children those songs, Tala and Madhwa Alayna. And that date was 12th Rabi of Nabla. The date when Prophet arrived at Medina was 12th Rabi of Nabla. So if the whole city can sing and dance and be happy, the Prophet come to Medina, then why we cannot be happy? So remembrance can take various forms. And sometimes that remembrance is structured. Every nation loves their country. And it takes many forms. One of the things is that they celebrate the Day of Independence. We have 4th of July here. We have August 14th there in Pakistan. When Saudi Arabia was created, after the war against Ottoman Caliphate, and Saudi state was created, they celebrate Al-Eid al-Madani. Nobody says this is bid'ah. This is true. We don't say it is bid'ah. Every nation celebrates. You can celebrate too. But we know that Prophet ﷺ created the first Muslim state in Medina. He didn't create Al-Eid al-Madani. So from their definition it becomes bid'ah. From our definition it doesn't. But we don't say that if an act is not done by Prophet and Sahaba, then that act becomes somehow bid'ah. This is not the definition of bid'ah in classical definition of Islam, or by any of the great scholars in the history of Islam. I have one other video on that, what is bid'ah. Anybody is interested, they should watch it. It is based on Kitab al-Bid'ah, Dr. Bahri, which is in Urdu and it's very long, 600-700 pages. But it summarizes the argument. Because in the history of Islam, we always had many things which came with the passage of time. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was reluctant to compile the Quran. He was reluctant because the Prophet didn't do it. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu started the Tarawih and he says, Ni'ma hazihil bid'ah. What a beautiful bid'ah. It was a new thing. Not been during the time of the Prophet. It was there. During the time of Hajjaj, the dots and Tanween and Nopat were placed in the Quran so people shouldn't make mistake in reading the Quran. Nobody says this is bid'ah. With the passage of time, ulama developed the law. We have fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa, fiqh of Imam Shafi. This development of law was not during the time of the Prophet. The system of madaris was not during the time of the Prophet. So there are many things which develop in the history of Islam that they are not considered in any way bad or wrong. Unless they lead to something bad. They lead to bad, then they have to be criticized. They lead to good, then you know, criticize them. So with the passage of time, Mawlid took a certain form all over the world, all over the Muslim world. And for 1,000 years, there is virtually no place on this earth where Muslims live and Mawlid is not celebrated. No place. Someone asked Imam Shah Dehlavi that what is your dalil for Mawlid? And he said, for 7 centuries, every alim in Makkah and Medina has been doing it. Hanafi, Shafi, Maliki, Hanbali, all of them have been doing it, and that is enough for me. And in fact, in his Yuzul Haramain, he mentioned his participation in many of the Mawlids, and he writes his spiritual awakening, what kind of experiences he had, and what did he see in the moment was going on. I go to Masjid al-Aqsa and every Friday morning there is Mawlid in Masjid al-Aqsa. And they told me that it's going on for centuries. We don't know how long. One time, it was 12th Rabiul Awwal, about 3 years ago, 4 years ago. And I did not know that it's 12th Rabiul Awwal because I was part of this basically non-Muslim group of people who were visiting. And there was one more Muslim and he said that we need to go to Al-Khalid, tomb of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. So we took a cab and we went to the tomb of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. And we were surprised because the whole city was there. Even they have a Jewish area where only Jews can go. But there were so many Muslims that even that area was taken over by Muslims and their military couldn't do anything. And we didn't remember that it was 12th Rabiul Awwal. The whole city was there and it was celebrated. And this is going on for centuries. centuries, thousands of years, it's going on. Now, and in the history of Islam, we see that the greatest ulama of this ummah, Imam Ibn Kasir, the student of Imam Ibn Tami, Imam Nawawi, Imam Bastilani, Imam Izzuddin Ibn Salam, Imam Yusuf Nabhani, Imams of all schools of thought, they have written books in praise of Mawlid. We have at least 500 books written by these ulama about Mawlid. Now to say that for 1,000 years, all these people who are the pillars of Islam and who took this religion to the far-flung area of the world, all of them didn't know what is bidah. And now we need to go to Saudi Arabia to find out what it is. It doesn't make sense. Because this deen stands on the collectivity of the thinking of Allah.
Yes.
And what they do, they will say, oh brother, we need Quran and Sunnah. As Quran and Sunnah is very simple and anybody can read and anybody can figure out what it is. Quran is the text, Sunnah is the text. But how to derive the law is a very complex process. Quran says you can drink alcohol if there is no prayer time. It's a verse in the Quran. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu la taqrabu as-salata wa antum sukara. And if I say, okay, after Isha I can drink because it's written in the Quran, you accept that, no? But can we deny the person? Yes, this is in the Quran. Quran says, go and kill mushrik wherever you find him. Uqtulul mushrikeen haithu saqiftuhum. Will we do that? Will we go out and start killing because Quran is saying we should kill them? Will we do that? No, we won't do that. It is the verse in the Quran. This is not al-hukm al-shari. Hukm al-shari is something which is denied. It's a very complex. They will all say that it's a big shirk if you make sajda to human being. I believe that too. It's shirk. Haram, not permissible. Right? But Quran says you can do it. Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, his children, they go and make sajda. In the Quran, فَخَرُّوا لَهُ سُجَّدًا. I say, okay, brother, I'll do it because Quran is saying I can do it. Can you stop me? So it is one thing that there is a verse in the Quran or there is a particular hadith. But what exactly is al-hukm al-shari, the command of Sharia, that is a very complex process through which that hukm is derived. You cannot take a verse and throw it as a rock at another person. But take a hadith and throw it as a rock, say, oh brother, this is hadith. No, it's a complex process. And unless you have qualified gentlemen ulama who interpret the text for you, you will end up in Daesh and Al-Qaeda in these groups. They're all quoting Quran, all quoting Hadith. So this is the difficulty and complexity of the time, that we are truly in an age of darkness, in which religious knowledge has eclipsed, and we have people who are just indulged in cheap sloganeering, demagoguery, cheap leadership, and they spread the things which are not authentic and criticize things which are authentic. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us that we should understand the truth.
Amen.
Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَهْدِنِي لِمَا اخْتُلِفَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. That when haq is contested and confusing, you should guide me to the truth. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us to the true path and to the best understanding of Islam.
Ameen.
And best understanding of our deen. And create love and peace and harmony in Muslim communities, not conflicts, divisions, and sectarians.
Ameen.
أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم وللسلام عليكم.